I want to talk about the foreign aid issue, which you've been all over. I also want to talk about what is percolating out there, which is a deal for the so-called dreamers, like the rest of us don't have dreams, but the dreamers, 800,000 people, all now adults, who were brought into the country, or 80% of them adults, who were brought in the country illegally and remained here. Obama gave them executive amnesty of sorts and let them work here and so forth. Now, for some reason, the Mitch McConnell wants to get a DACA deal done by the end of January, if possible. What would have to be in any deal, from your point of view, to ensure that 800,000 illegal immigrants, an electoral wave that would cross this country like a few others we've seen, 800,000 new voting citizens?
The first thing that I've proposed is that they should not add to the immigration totals. So we admit about 1 million people a year. We're one of the more generous countries with immigration. It shouldn't be 1 million plus the 800,000. It should be 1 million minus the 800,000. And so you could do that. And what you could do is if you did it over 4 or 5 years, you do background checks and you make sure that they're not criminals and haven't, committed any crimes, but then you'd subtract them from the immigration totals. That's the first thing I would do. The second thing I would do is you have to get something else in exchange. I think ending chain migration is one, and I think border security is a second one. The only thing I would caution on the wall is I'm still conservative even when it comes to money on a wall. They're talking about $40 billion for a wall. I think we have done, somebody told me the other day, one of the senators mentioned that we have done, I think it's 2,700 miles of concrete barriers on highways for $2 billion. So there's somewhere got to be some kind of in between there, and we shouldn't just say, hey, whatever you want to spend, go ahead and spend it. We do need to still be fiscally conservative on how we build the wall and how we build the barriers. I've long said that you could have helicopter stations every 50 miles and have drone surveillance and have zero tolerance, and you wouldn't have to have a wall.
That only works, Rand.
Senator, that only works.
And every time I hear virtual wall, I'm like, okay, they're not serious about enforcing the border. And I know you are, but here's what happens in that regard. People cross the border, and they present themselves to immigration officials. And then they're held for 2 weeks, and then they're released. If you have a helicopter, they'll see them crossing.
You'd have to change it, and you'd have to have a zero tolerance policy, and you'd have to say that everyone picked up will be returned within 24 hours, if not immediately. And so nobody would be coming inland. No one would be given a ticket or a summons to appear 30 days later. Everyone would be reposited back across the border. And I think a lot of it is, even now, some are saying there's less of a problem because the Trump administration has shown that they have the wherewithal to actually send people back and not to let them come further in across the border. So some of it is showing that willpower. But I do think it can be a combination. I'm not against building walls. I'm just still not throwing out the fact that I'm fiscally conservative when it comes to a wall. We still need to look at and examine the amount on the wall.
What about the cost
and
of
how
it?
We do it?
Yeah, but what about the cost of keeping them here? The CBO numbers on that were shocking.
I agree.
Yeah,
I think
that's billions a year. And $20 billion in services to all the illegal immigrants and $20 billion out of the country just to Mexico.
The other thing that should come with the DACA deal, if there is a DACA deal, is that really we need to select who comes to this country. It has been estimated that if anybody could come, 700 million people would come to this country next month. So since so many people want to come to this country, why don't we select out for the best of the best, the most patriotic, the most pro-American, and not admitting people through a diversity lottery who want to plow down citizens in New York City on a terrorist spree. So I think getting rid of the diversity lottery, making merit based immigration, having great scrutiny for those who want to come to our country, visit wise or to live in our country. We can do a great deal more, and I think the DACA deal allows there to be some leverage in finally getting the Democrats to agree to some of these things.
Let's move on to what Jeff Sessions announced today. Then we're going to get into the foreign aid issue. Jeff Sessions announced he's rescinding that Obama-era directive for the federal U.S. attorneys to back off marijuana enforcement in states with legalized pot. What Jeff Sessions says now, he's going to leave it to the discretion of federal officials in our states and remove that basic advisory against bringing cases involving those states where marijuana is legal. I know you're a libertarian. I am not. I look at the scourge of drug use and know too many people who started on marijuana and ended up either dead on opioids or sticking a needle in their arm. But tell us where you are on this new decision.
Well, the first thing I would say is just because I believe in freedom doesn't mean I'm in favor of drugs, and I agree with you, drugs are a scourge. I would say with the heroin and the opioid problem, really most of it's actually come in the beginning from prescription drugs. People who were prescribed opioids and then went to heroin, 4 out of 5 people on heroin started out with prescription opioids. With regard to the federal government coming in and controverting state law, you know, on marijuana, it's going to be quite difficult because some of these states not only have been doing medical marijuana for a decade or more, now some of them are doing recreational. It'll be virtually impossible. I think it's a mistake for the Department of Justice to do this, but it'll be virtually impossible. They would have to send an army and federal troops in there. There's no way it's going to change.
So you think state law should preempt federal drug laws?
I think what you should do is, since the states have decided to legalize this, we should get rid of any federal encumbrances that
wow.
make it difficult to have a legal business. For example, right now,
what if they do it to child pornography?
Cannot,
what if they do it with child pornography and states decide, well, it's okay to have an age of consent lowered?
The IRS currently says that if you run a medical marijuana industry in Colorado, you cannot deduct the wages of your workers. So what happens is many of these entities either don't file federal taxes or have been disputing their federal taxes for a decade, and the federal government hasn't gotten anything from these. The state government taxes them at the sale point of marijuana, and so they've actually, in Colorado and different states, collected millions and millions of dollars. And people are looking at the crime statistics, but actually most of the studies that I've seen have not seen an increase in crime, have actually seen crime continuing its downward trend. So I don't know. There are arguments back and forth for it. I think in all practical purposes, no matter what the Department of Justice decides to do, it's practically impossible for them to come in and try to overturn Colorado or California or Nevada or Washington or Oregon law.
Well, the cost, and you know, you're a medical professional, but the medical costs of legalization and the increase in pot usage by those from the ages of 12 to 17, the American Academy of Pediatrics, which don't, they don't really take a position on legalization, they just did the, you know, they just did the studies of it. It's skyrocketing, and that's what paving the way for legalization does. So it changes the young brain.
Well, I think the bigger problem, the bigger problem, Laura, I would say, is not marijuana; it's prescription opioids. And if you look at the problem of heroin and the addiction to prescription opioids, this is devastating our country. More people are dying from car accidents, are dying from opioids than car accidents.
Well, it's freedom
now. It really has been
if people want to
really
take it, why can't they take it? You're a libertarian. Take opioids. So what? If marijuana is legal, why not opioids?
Well, the thing is it's legal for doctors to prescribe a whole host of things, but it's not advisable to sometimes prescribe let's say your kid gets his wisdom teeth out, should we give them 100 OxyContin? So people have been over-prescribing these things, and then also the drug company, there's Purdue Pharma, came in the 1990s and said, oh, it's not addictive. And so they sold this, and they actually ended up paying a fine, a $630 million fine. There's a great book on this called Dreamland, and in it they talk about how a lot of people got hooked because of doctors doing the wrong thing. So it's not really a freedom issue. It's actually a medical issue on whether it's advisable to prescribe OxyContin and highly addictive drugs for long-term pain control.
Yeah, well, China's dumping in fentanyl like it's gone out of style, and you take fentanyl once and you're hooked, and so this is I know it's not the cool position. I'm not worried about being the cool cat, but I think this is going to go down as one of the worst decisions for our country and our overall well-being. Forget what it means for money or people making money. Billionaires are investing in pot fields, and I just think as it affects our country, our well-being, our children, brain development, all of it, it will go down as a disastrous decision. I'm not for locking people up. I'm not saying people lock people up for recreational use, but I am saying that the tacit approval of pot use and the glamorization of pot use is going to ensure that we have more addicts and more people in serious mental health decline. That's my concern, Senator. I'll let you close it out.
I think, though, if you looked at the problem, you'd probably, if we looked at it and tried to weigh which is a bigger problem, that or the opioid problem, I think it's really the prescription opioid problem that is... but they're different problems, and they aren't necessarily the same problem. And the opioid problem has a direct linkage to the heroin problem. And the addiction to opioids is well proven and well accepted, and marijuana being addictive isn't really so much accepted.
Well, 9% of those who begin to use marijuana become addicted, and of the young people, and if you use it daily, 17% become addicted. That's not nothing. That's something. But, Senator, we're not going to agree on this, but we are so happy that you're doing better and so happy that you're back. We need your voice out there. And Pakistan is going to get a big cut in aid. I couldn't be happier. And the UN is going to get less money. I'm happy. You must be ecstatic about that.
Well, we have a bill, actually, that we're going to reintroduce next week that would take the money we send to Pakistan, about $2 billion, and put it directly into an infrastructure fund.
Great.
I haven't met anybody. I've traveled the country. I don't meet anybody that thinks we should be sending the money to Pakistan.
None.
I meet a lot of people that say, why can't we fix our roads and bridges here?
Bingo. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. You have to come on TV with me when you drop that. So we'll talk to you offline about that. Say hi to all the staff and Sergio and all the guys. And Kelly, and I'm just so glad you're on the mend. Senator Rand.